That's a glimpse of the ceremony. In the film, we'll see it in very vibrant terms. Now, whether they have ecstasy or not is a matter of speculation. We cannot know. Many of them, starting with Rumi himself, have claimed that they do experience a trance. As far as I'm concerned, that is their wishful thinking. Now here we have, in the middle, the sheikh, who doesn't whirl with them so much, but comes in usually toward the end and makes some gentle turns, which you'll see in the film too. There's a red dyed sheepskin there. That is a representation, a symbol of the sun of the sky. It's virtually circular, as much as a sheepskin can be. And that represents the memory of Shams, the man who inspired Rumi to take up Sufism, because Shams meant the sun. And Selim III, the reformist sultan of the late 18th and early 19th century, was a great supporter of the whirling dervishes. He could play the ney himself very beautifully, and he was a composer whose songs are still being played and sung in Turkey. And he composed a cycle of music for the ceremonies of the dervishes, and that's still performed by them. There are now 6 to 7 different cycles in their repertoire, and one of them is by the Ottoman Sultan Selim III. He was a very gentle soul, a very poetic soul, and he was extremely respectful of artists. For instance, in the Ottoman tradition, no sultan ever rose to his feet when somebody came into his presence, not even the ambassadors of the most important foreign powers. But when his own music teacher, a Greek, came into his presence, he would always rise to his feet and greet his teacher that way. It's interesting also that the great Armenian musician Hamparsum, who devised a very effective system of notation for Turkish classical music, lived and produced his work, at least part of his work, during the reign of Selim III. This happens to be the 150th anniversary of the death of Hamparsum. There's a tragic story to the end of Selim III. He was dethroned by the Janissaries, and shortly after that, he was attacked on the top of the palace grounds, where he was incarcerated, and he was playing his ney. At the time, his killers came in with their swords, and he tried to defend himself with his ney against the swords of the men who came to kill him. Mahmud II, also a reformist sultan of the 19th century, was a very accomplished Mevlevi calligrapher, and he abolished the Janissary system and started the new European type army in Turkey. Abdülmecid was very fond of them, and he attended at least once their diploma ceremony and had a meal with the graduating students. So there was always this type of support from the Sultan. And the Ottoman Empire created not only the magnificent reality and the silhouettes of Orthodox mainstream Islamic civilization, but also the dynamics of the mystical spirit expressed through so many beautiful poems and philosophical tracts and music and other arts. When the Turkish Republic was established by Mustafa Kemal Pasha, shortly after the establishment of the Republic, in the year 1924, Mustafa Kemal Pasha visited Konya and went into the mausoleum of Mevlana Celaleddin Rumi, and in his own hand wrote the following in the guest book. Every visitor to Mevlana Jalaluddin Rumi's mausoleum is a refugee from reactionary dogma. The idea of soaring to God, standing, whirling, in motion, is a natural expression of the Turkish genius. Rumi is a lover of transformation who transcends the ages, a great reformer who welded Islam to the Turkish soul. He upheld the principles of social revolution and the freedom of conscience. These are very interesting observations and statements by Mustafa Kemal Pasha. However, a year later, his program of secularization started, and all congregation places, all the buildings belonging to sects were under a single law closed. Yet shortly thereafter, the mausoleum of Mevlana Celaleddin Rumi was turned into a museum and was open to visitation again. And later in the 1950s, that became the first sect whose members were allowed to do their rituals in public. In fact, with some government support, they went to Europe, and later they came to the United States to show their rituals. So there is now a greater acceptance of them. And this is what they do. There are very few of them. The numbers are unbelievably small. I don't know the exact numbers, but I think in Ankara there are only about 40 of them. In Istanbul, less than 100. And that's about the limit. They are very possessive and in a way, jealous of their own dervish status, and they don't want to admit others outsiders, either as branches or offshoots of the sect or as individual members. There are a number of people in the United States who have the costumes and who do the whirling, etc. Americans in different parts of the United States, in New York and in California particularly. And yet, when they've applied, they've always been turned down or they've never received an answer. So the sect is not growing and it's become, to a certain extent, hereditary. And they turn as though they are living statues with tremendous poise, yet while they make those gentle turns, there's always a sense of excitement, a sense of exhilaration and exaltation that you sense watching. It's a very exciting thing to witness. And please remember when you're watching the film later on that they always turn left to right. They turn left because left is where the heart is, where love resides. That is why they must always turn and whirl toward love and nothing else. Now the right hand opens up that way, and the left arm is extended this way, a slight tilt usually, but not necessarily. However, the right palm must point upward. That is a definite rule, never anything else. And the symbolism of that is that the dervish receives the benediction and the beauty of God and transmits it without keeping anything to himself, because that would be crass possessiveness, that would be selfishness. But they transmit all that light, all that beauty, all that wisdom to the world, to other people who might need it. Therefore, the left hand points downward. And that symbolism is very important when you watch it. As in this case. And here, presumably, this young dervish is beginning to experience not only ecstasy, but almost elevation. And the feeling of this is, in a poem by Rumi, expressed as follows. What is this whirling of ours? A greeting from the inmost friends of the heart. When their messages arrive, they give the weary soul vigor and comfort. Caught in this wind, the mind's branches reach out and bloom all over again. One gentle flap, and the body finds its peace. The rooster crows at dawn, the climate of the soul, the sentinel's cry resounds with the king's triumph. The roll of drums The ecstatic soul pulls out a fistful of arrows and takes aim at the body. Strange sweetness, never felt before, spreads through the flesh, and the mouth revels in the luscious taste of the reed flute and the player's lips. Look at these thousands of scorpions, writhing, curling, dying. We hold no drink in our hands, yet the hour of a thousand joys whirls around us. Words can never contain or portray or praise the beauty of the invisible face. Look deep with a thousand borrowed eyes, it still lies beyond sight. Let the whirling run wild and take flight, for you are life added to the life of the whirling ecstasy. You are the glittering joy of the age. This man, who was so fond of both ecstasy and inner peace, was also deeply committed to the idea of peace in the world. One of his most important sentences is, "When weapons and ignorance come together, pharaohs arise to devastate the world with their cruelty." That statement, I think, should be a slogan for the United Nations, might well be. There were many other sects in the Anatolian tradition, some Sunni, Orthodox, mainstream, including the Bayrami sect, which was always quite close to the establishment and gave tremendous support to the nationalist movement of Mustafa Kemal Pasha from 1918 to 1922. And then there's the Bayrami sect, which is very lovely in its theology and its doctrine. And then the Naqshbandi sect, which also has its inspiration from the earliest sect of the Ahmed Yesevi in Khorasan. And that sect is quite widespread in Turkey. And it is said that a number of cabinet members, at least in the previous cabinet, and possibly the prime minister himself, are members of that sect. I think some of you have heard probably a very eloquent lecture about them, given here by Professor Sherif Mardin, my dear friend. There are also Rifa'is who perform very horrifying rituals. They lacerate themselves, particularly when they feel that they've reached the height of ecstasy, and that's a terrible thing to see. They not only walk on burning coal, which is relatively less painful, I think, but they actually use knives and swords to lacerate themselves. And then there's the Halveti Jarrahi sect. That has made many appearances in the United States, supported by oil money. And they went from city to city. And what they used to do at the very beginning, in their first tour in the United States, was they brought their men who could put a skewer through their cheeks. And keeping it there, they would turn with all the others. That's actually a very simple trick, it seems. It shocks everybody at the very beginning. But later you realize that, been proven medically, that we have just a little empty spot in our cheeks. And if you can find the right spot, it doesn't hurt, it doesn't bleed. You just put it through and it comes out at the other end. Don't try it, please. There are also Alevi sects, which are related, of course, to the Shiite movement, the Kizilbash and Tahtaju, and the Bektashis are to a certain extent considered Sunni, but in their secret doctrine that they are Shiite. There's the Hurufiya Yazidi